I had the opportunity to go to YAPC Europe last month, and I just would like to give you a sum up of what information, what modules and ideas I grabbed there. It's not everything that was talked at YAPC Europe, just a short sum up, at least things that I've seen. It's not very balanced talk because there are so many topics on that, but mainly ideas, topics, tools that you can grab from that talk to use on a daily basis or not. So YAPC Europe, it's not as we told, it's not really about the same size as YAPC NA, little smaller, less talks, but very interesting. And this year, a lot of Japanese guy coming to YAPC Europe. So
where? 1 second. So you're kind of new. You know what YAPC is?
Yet another program.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Okay.
Yeah. Sure, yeah. That's very bad name, and everyone is pushing to change the name, but everyone that knows it is would like to keep it. So. Yeah. That's another topic. So this is a kind of topic that we'd like to show. It will be pretty short, and that's just to. I'm not going to list them. You can read them more than me. So we are going to start by. Where was YAPC Europe? It was in Granada. Unfortunately, that was not this one there. I would love to go there, but no. This was here, Granada. So south of Spain. Very difficult to travel there because it's not international airport, and you need to go to have a stop at Malaga. And of course, you have no direct flight coming from US. So once you arrive there, it's a very beautiful place, very famous for the place named La Alhambra. And of course, you can see the camel who was waiting for us already. On the YAPC, the conferences happen at the university, one of the science university. So one of the first talks I attended was Web Scrappers from Sawyer, and Sawyer is pretty well known in the Perl community. So what is a Web Scrapper? A Web Scrapper, it's a way to extract content from a web page or web service. So in fact, you extract the content, you parse it, and you display your piece of content, in fact. So why do you need a web scrapper? One of the main reasons is that websites live and change permanently. And even if a website provide an API, the API might be desynchronized regarding the contents. And doing it your own could make sense in some case, even if the website provide an API. And some websites don't have API, so you need to extract the content using user agent and parse it and query it. And that's one place where Perl exceed when you need to use regex and extract content from. That's Perl is very useful for that kind of stuff. So this would be the easiest or lightest web scrapper that you could think about. So you initialize your user agent, and then you ask to do a get query to that web page, and you check if it succeeds, or in that case, you return the content. So you have done nothing with the content, but you just did your very, very first web scrapper. But so you're mainly focused on two modules. You probably heard about them, probably using them, I don't know. One is mechanized, and the second is web query. So when you think about mechanized, you really need to keep in mind that just mechanized is just a web browser. It has all the functionality that a web browser has, refresh, back, and so on, click on the link. So this is mechanized. On web query, it's more modern, the thing that you will have iterators and selector. And we are going to view both of them. So this is a mechanized sample. So you create your user agent. You can even set your user agent string with whatever you want, your robot name, whatever. So then after, you ask for a GET request on one URL, you can say, please click on the first link that will match that regex. So the user agent is going to click on that link, and then after you can ask to refresh the page content, or you can also submit a post request on the form exactly as you were filling the fields manually using a keyboard. It's very, if you are using a,
And the mechanized object keeps the state of where you are.
Yeah.
Is that, I'm asking.
Yeah, yes?
Okay, so when you do a follow link, mechanized knows what page you're on now, so a reload will reload that page, not the original page.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So that's one of the first approach. One of the second one, let's take that very dummy code of HTML code, one div with two DT, for example. And you can use your web query on that, on one specific URL, and ask to find the div head on DT element, and then you can iterate on each of them. So you will, on that sub, you will have two things. The first element will be the index, the number, starting at zero. And the second one, the dollar underscore here, is the web query object. Okay, that the so you then you can feed external or global or local hashes or whatever you want there. That's the idea. And very useful. Don't know if I no yes. Unfortunately, I do not have more sample of that. But just have a look at the pod on this one. Perl pod on this one is very very good.
What's happening here? I'm sorry.
On the
that's how you're.
Yeah, so for example, that sample will display some text and then two text on two lines. And we are doing nothing with the index. But you can do something if you want. And you can iterate on something, right? And you can have more complex things. One other talk I attended to was from Mark Overmeer, author of POSIX 103. And he talked about the complexity of POSIX. So POSIX kind of a standard. The goal is to standardize the operating systems on many different libraries or OS levels. So POSIX is part of Perl by itself since Perl exist. But POSIX first, it's difficult because if you have a look at the documentation for print, print says print a string on. Returns true if successful. If you can print the string, then it returns true. It's kind of very fuzzy to how would I know that my print succeeds? If you are pointing to a printer, if you are pointing to a tape, whatever, kind of difficult to know, it can be asynchronized. So that's one of the first difficulties of POSIX there. The second one is that, as I said, POSIX is as old as Perl. And this is the official Perl doc on POSIX, and you can see that. Say the most complex Perl module supplied with the standard distributions. Yes, it is. It's a great source of wisdom, as you can see. So that just gives you an idea. It's also weak because, for example, for select, Perl has two functions. And the sub there, kind of crazy. That's one extra of POSIX 103 to normalize the select. But honestly, I do not really understand why you are pushing on dev there, but totally, I'm going to skip this one. So POSIX has other issues. I'm not going to, for example, just to get the $$, which is the get PID, you have 12 simple rewrites. You have many croaks in the code saying, use this method instead of this one. So it's not very, not the best way to, if you want to go in that direction. So POSIX 103 has for main goal to provide a better POSIX API for Perl and more usable. So first thing is divided in submodules. This is just an extract of how it's divided. And there was one trick I enjoy in POSIX. I don't know if you are using exporter on particularly the export level there. They were implementing their own import level. So what does mean import level? When you are importing a module, when you are using a module in your namespace, you are going to, if you do not use parents or if you specifically import some function, these functions are going to be kind of copied in your namespace, at least accessible in your namespace. And if you use that number here, you say, please do not add them to my namespace, but to the caller, the parent namespace, which is calling me. So I would like to show you. This is the code here. And this is something that I would like to steal and use in my own code, because it's pretty easy to do on your own. So the main thing is you see the first regex with the backslash D plus there, which means on the plus before the backslash D, which means, OK, if we have a number there, then we are going to use that number as a specific level. And then later, we are going to say color on that level, which means we are going to get the namespace of the color N plus the number. And then when we are going to hook the function, plug the function at star 2, we are going to use that namespace to plug the function. So that's light, easy. You can use exporter, but just nice to know. Yeah. So another talk that was there as I'm was from Rainy from cPanel. Rainy is currently working on BC. I don't know if you are using B modules. The goal of BC is to take your Perl programs on emit C code that will represent the op tree, so freeze the op tree in a C code. So then after you can compile that C code using GCC, and you will win that tokenize on that tree parsing times. And one other advantage of BC is that you will have at the end a binary, which means that if you are shipping code to your customers, you can have that binary without any access to the source code. So you will have faster startup and no need to ship any other dependencies than Perl by itself.
Is it actually working now?
At cPanel, we are using it since 2014 with 5.14.4. I will not suggest you to use it with a more recent version than 5.14.4. And currently, on my daily job, I'm working on 5.22 with 4BC. Huh. Okay. So if you want to use BC, use 5.14.4. And in a few months, maybe in 1 month, I hope that you could use 5.22.
Oh, I had no idea that it was actually, because that's something that's been around for years.
But so BC can have its own talk by itself, because it's...
Well, since 2014.
Yeah. Well, cPanel was using BC before 2014, but it was using BC with Perl 5.6, because it was not stable with a higher version than 5.6. OK. So YAPC Europe, but maybe about 10, 12 Japanese guys were there, a big community of Japanese, and they nearly all of them had a talk on one topic. And the leitmotiv they were using is, why are we so fast? Oh, because we are Japanese, yeah. So that was the joke. One module web service simple, I don't know if you heard about this one. It looks pretty nice to simply plug and do an API request, because you can create your object, your API object using default parameters in the first param there. And each time you are going to ask for a GET or a POST request, the default parameters will be automatically appended to the URL construction. So that's an easy way to query one API using a token or something like this, for example. And you can do GET, POST, I think. I don't know if you have any question there. It's pretty straightforward. One next module is Server Starter. So if you are using Plaque and any kind of Plaque application, you would like to have So what's this one? Yeah, you would like to have probably you are using Starman or other server. On Server Starter claims to do a graceful restart, which is probably one of the most interesting feature, which means the whole process is only going to take place if it succeeds. We are going to kill the old process only if the new one succeeds. So I not read the code deeply to know how they were doing that, but that's one very safe feature that you might consider to deploy your Starman application. And Starlet can be it's a Plaque server, simple and performant. And the thing is that you can use Plaque, you can use a start server with backup. You can combine both together. So in the previous sample, we were using start server with Starman, and now we are using start server with backup. And you can use many options for tuning the web server on the command line. So it's a work. So another module was Cookie Baker. So do not use cgi.pm if you want to handle cookie. Either do it yourself or use this one or any other flavors. And it's a very easy way to build a cookie and display the string later on your app if you do not have anything for that. You can also, you can go in both sides. You can create your cookie or you can read your cookie. So that's, exactly, the last line. Yeah, bake on Scratch. So Gazelle is another PAGI server claiming to be extremely fast, on the, at least on any world, on the, even on the regular app. They say 2 times faster than Starman. I've not checked. It really depends on your app, probably, what you are doing. But it may be worth to try. So another HTTP client. FURL, which is light and fast. Yeah, the same thing. It's another HTTP client. That might be pretty very low on dependencies. Yeah. And you can do a get and post request and specify your headers, any custom headers. So it's very easy to use. In fact, you just now you see the full doc, just reading the 2 slides. Another module that was displayed is a way to have a simple blog with static files. So this is Rigi. So mainly it's using Git, and you can edit your MD files and then start your server on all the files will be generated statically. And you can publish them to any blog or whatever. Another Japanese module was Perlint. I don't know if you are using Perl Critic or Perl. So this is another one, normally we made from scratch, and claiming to be faster, as you can see the benchmark below there.
Faster
than Perl? 78%. So. One main advantage, what I like about this one is, well, it's the same with the others also, but you can pretty easily plug your own policy. So this is one very dummy policy, for example, to forbid return statement with explicit and def. So you create your package, you extend from the correct parent, and then you have access to the current tokens. And at the token, you can check, you can ask for the next token to see if you have then returned on, if the first one is returned, and if the second one equal undef, for example, it's a default on contain undef. So in that case, you can simply raise an error relation. So you can think about extending it pretty easily with your own. Next one, you probably have heard, or if you have not heard about Miyagawa. Oh, oops, there is a typo there. And Miyagawa is pretty productive on CPAN. He has a lot of modules. Most of them are very commonly used now. I mainly think about CPAN, Minus, PSGI, Plaq, Starman. I don't know if you are using Carton, or if you consider using Carton, or if you know what is Carton, but the idea of Carton is to package your module version to redeploy the same version later when you are going to a different environment, different production, to be sure that you are going to use the same version. One of the main disadvantages of Carton is that it's slow. You always need to recompile the modules. On the kind of Carmel, it's a different name, but you really need to think about it as Carton too. And Carmel is trying to solve that slowness issue. And we are going to, I'm not doing a live demo, but slides from something that looks like a live demo. So the idea is Carton with a cache. Okay. Once you, so of course you will need to compile a module, but once that module is compiled and installed, the idea is to share it among your apps and never reinstall it again on your computer or on your server. So that module is installed. You can customize it where you want, but for example, it's installed in the home directory, in the Carmel directory. And there's one specific directory with the version and the arch name. So for example, of course, if you are using a different Perl version, if you are using different architectures, you definitely need to reinstall the modules. But if you are using the same Perl version for the same distro, there's no reason to not to reinstall it one more time. So it's going to be installed there. Okay, for example, here we have three modules installed. And you can see, for example, that URI, we have two different versions, 163 and 164. So the idea, if you are using cpanminus, you are probably using a cpan file that will allow you to specify some dependencies on some rules to say, I really want that version, or I want a version lower than or greater than. And you can then install them using the install depths. Okay? So Carmel is also preserving that cpan file.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
No problem. So that was for cpanm. So now Carmel. Okay, this is not only the doc of Carmel. At the time I wrote these slides, I was just coming back from YAPC Europe, and Miyagawa planned to release the Carmel 1.0 at YAPC Europe. He could not do that. So some of these features there might be different today if you download a fresh version of Carmel. I've not checked in the last weeks. But that's the main idea. You install a module, you can list and treat them, and we're going to see most of these commands later. Okay, that's... So, let's say I create my cpan file, where I will specify that I would like DSQLite on DBI, and I simply run Carmel install, and it's going to install these two modules on all dependencies exactly as cpanminus or Carton, but they are going to be installed in my home directory. Okay, so yeah, in the Carmel directory with the architectures on the Perl version. Okay, they are not going to be in my project. So once you have installed them, you can run Carmel list or Carmel tree. So Carmel list will list all the modules available installed for your current Perl version. And Carmel tree will show the dependencies between them. So now you can simply ask to Carmel what the version of Dancer I'm currently using for that app. So you just say Carmel show Dancer, and it will show you that you are using the 1.15 in your home directory. Okay, so now how do you need a way to warp these modules with your applications and use a local lib. So for that, you have two different flavors. The very first one will be simply to require use Carmel setup in your application or in your program. On the second option will be to use a global environment variable with these two below, where you are setting one extra Carmel path and you are appending it to Perl 5 opt. Okay, and if I'm not using Carmel setup, when I'm going to use Dancer will be from the system, here it's the operating system on my Mac, but from your current Perl version. So now, the good thing, is that if I want, the main idea of Caramel is that you are going to manage your dependencies using your Git repo. Okay, you have that cpan file. You would like to experiment some new modules available on cpan. So you just commit, for example, with this new version there. Say, oh, let's try the new dancer module. And you install it. So once you install it, it's going to install that version on any extra required dependencies. Okay. And then later, when you're going to use it, you are going to use that version. The very, very good thing is that if you need to go back and switch from branch A to branch B, where branch A will contain the old version, branch B will contain the new version, when you will say Caramel install, it will just do kind of, not symlink, but it will not reinstall the modules because all the modules are already installed with the two different versions there. That's the main advantage of Caramel. And that's why, in fact, it's pretty good on the development box. I'm not so sure I will use it for deployment. You might have different solution for deployment, but for on production, when you want to test different modules, different version, extremely fast. And you are sharing that among all your apps. So you can have some apps that are still using one old version, whereas the other is using a new one. Yeah, so that's... And then you can ask Caramel to see, please list me all the versions for a specific module that are installed on my servers. And you can pick the one you want and try the one you want or uninstall it. Okay, on this one, yeah. So now you might want to have them in kind of vendor directory, in a local directory. You can use rollout that will pick up these modules from your Caramel directory and copy them in your current project directory. You need to be aware about XS and architectures issue that might be aware there. It's with, so, but it might be useful for some kind of deployment if you, depending on the kind of module and architectures you are using. And then after, yeah. So the idea is that once you have done the rollout, if you ask Caramel where is the dancer module I'm using, it will be your local vendor directory. And if you do not want to use it, just remove that directory. That's all. So the architecture of the local directory created. So you have any bin installed by a package, and then the current tree will leave Perl 5 on the lib, probably. Yeah, nothing special there. Yeah, and then you remove the local directory, and as I was saying, you are going back to the previous version. So here I was still using the 1.3 dancer. Now I just edit the cpan file and then uncomment or downgrade my module. And when I will run Caramel install, it will simply set them for the current package and no reinstall required there. You cannot see the thing that if I was doing a live demo, for example, if I was using dancer or mouse or that kind of module with flood dependencies, you will see that the very first time will be very slow to install, and then all others will be extremely fast. So here, it's faster than any other because you're reusing the previously installed modules. Many other ideas on grid modules that I'm not going to cover in that talk. That's test MySQLD might be good at provide a single MySQL instance for testing. What else? Yeah, JSON web token, why not? And test Valgrind if you want to trust memory leaks and that kind of stuff. Yeah, no, MRuby, it's more for mobile. And that's all. At least that's the main one I've seen in Europe.
Already used it before? No, I've been following it.
So I will email the slides to the mailing list.
Yeah.
At least a link to the slides. But if we have little more time, and I don't know how many times usually we have, I've got a second topic that I can introduce. It's old, but it's interesting. So you are probably aware about all that kind of stuff, but I think it's really worth the. Where do we have this one? Okay. So that talk is about Perl on object. So everyone knows that Perl is not an object-oriented language. But so how and why using Perl object? So I the first time I did that talk, that was kind of where when a mouse and all that kind of crazy modules come on the. On the fashion, and so why, when, and how use object in Perl? So first thing first, Perl, it's about mainly three things: hashes, arrays, and scalars. And if you know AV, HV, and SV internally, so Perl programs. You are going to store your data. You have function and you need to store your data. Your data are mainly going to be stored in hashes, like the first hash, which is a reference to a hash, and then arrays on hash. So at the end, using that kind of structures might be very difficult to investigate and to know exactly which key, where is my data. So you will need to use dumper tools to see where it is, or you will need to do some deep investigation in the code. It's a nightmare and prone to many errors. So that's when you are not using object. As you can see, for example, you do not know, you don't know where is your data. You need to dig for it. And it can move or not, and you can do mistakes. Here, for example, you can do mistakes. That's the worst because Perl will simply be silent on that kind of mistakes. And it might take you hours, minutes, days to discover it. And you probably all have that kind of mistake somewhere in your code if you're using hashes. So the other thing is that the problem is that once you start using a hash and expose that hash externally to your module, to your package, that will be a nightmare. Because if you want to improve the data storage behind this, you will not be able to do that without upgrading all your code. So that's very, very, very bad habit to expose the structure of a hash outside of your current namespace. The other thing is that if you need, at one point, to plug some hook to control the data cycle, like do something when I change that value, or do something when I read it, or check something when I read it. If you are using direct hash all along your programs, you will not be able to do that. It will be long and painful to do that. So more than simply Perl rules, it's more like any language. It will be these kind of rules are true in any language, JavaScript, Ruby, Python, whatever, the same thing. If you are using direct access to the data, you will have these issues. So the thing is that you need one accessor. More than one accessor, you need one single. And that accessor should be the guard of that data, the only and single way to access it. OK, so this is a simple accessor where if you are going to set the value or you're going to read it. In fact, you are always reading it and returning it. Another thing is that if you need to write documentations, using object, it's bad, and going to move. Whereas if you'd simply provide one single API, and that API is a simple method, you can then do whatever you want behind the hood and no one will be really aware of what of that thing on any structural adjustment. So an object, you probably all know about that. It's an instance of a class that will provide function on internal attributes or with the data itself. So many reasons why using object. One of the first, I'm not sure it's there, but one of the first is when you have a project with many developers, using object-oriented program help you to divide that code in semantic on part on having multiple teams working on them. The other thing is that your code can be easier. You can reuse your code easier. The main idea behind this is that do not repeat yourself, do it only once. You can catch the errors easier, because if you do a typo on a function name, you will be aware of that rather than a typo on a hash name. In fact, it's going to solve nearly all the disadvantages we saw previously. On your code will be organized like this with same the principle of packages also in Perl. For example, with you can use roles, okay, kind of interface if you use Java or that kind of stuff. So the main advantage is you have kind of a one abstract class or not, depending on your project. But for example, the page define how to create something, and then you have a special document that would like to use the common basis but do something before and after. You can do that using the same logic. So this is principle of roles. One other thing is that you could use types on the types checking, which means you say whatever you are going to store in that value ABC is going to croak somewhere. Oh, it's going to. I will see that error. Okay. And then you can specify so that's the most principle there. So type more type checking here. What do we do? Yeah, so the bad type usage, for example, for sex. Yeah, sex should be only the letter M or F in that case. And I'm using a subtype, so I create okay. Let's create the type sex, which is a subtype of string, only with M and F. And then you can use that type in your attributes. Okay. But the very, very good thing now about starting using type is that you could use coercions. On coercions, you need to be careful with that, because too many coercions could be kind of difficult to debug or whatever. But for example, you can extend and you can say, convert from type A to type B using that special rules or functions. So for example, we create a type day, my type day, which we say it's a that time, which means a that time object, that time blessed class element. And if we have a string and that string match that pattern, then we can simply use the that time format package to parse it and return the that time object. So that way to do the correction there. So later in your code, you can create your object using either that time now for the day or simply a string. And the string will be automatically converted to that time object. That's what I'm showing in the last three lines there. So object. On Perl. So Perl is not object, but Perl provides many packages to develop in kind of an object way. Mouse, moose, mouse, moo, mo, m, which is a joke, and fizz and all others are way to do object. When I start working with object on that mouse thing, the main blocker for us was the number of dependencies coming with mouse. The problem is that if you have a simple app, you want to deploy that app on many servers, you do not want to install 15 modules to use this. So at one point, we consider you could also consider using your own object, even if at least it will be instructive, but it's probably not the best performance thing to do. So definitely, if you need to use one, mouse is definitely the fast one, the one that will provide any advantage or all the features. But the problem is that you might only consume one whereas you will have all of them there. So what? If you're familiar with mouse, perfectly fine, go with it. If you start, you might consider to use something lighter, which not only has the same syntax as mouse, Moo, okay? Moo is definitely probably the one I will recommend to anyone starting object in Perl, because if you need more feature, you could easily later switch to mouse. So there are some limitations where you can only use one role at a time, and but that's the only thing you want. You want to set an attribute, defining that attribute, you will have accessors on the setter. But okay. So now some would say, okay, object, but I need performance. There is one named class XS accessor. That one, only provide getters and do not provide setters. So it really depends on what you are doing. You might consider using it, but I will probably not choose this one. It will depend on what you are doing. This one is better for read access. Okay. Then as I said, you can write your own object module. If you want to write something like M, just need something like this. So the import function that, for example, you will say, use my object ABC. So the ABC will be there in the at underscore you are going to map. And for each of them, you are going to create a function. You are going to plug a function in the caller package. And that function will simply the get accessor below that will do the get and set, in fact. So that can be your, if you are not authorized to use any of the moo's thing, that thing could, or that thing could be a standalone object. So this is the usage of that class. So you see, for example, my object, list of attributes, and then later you can say, you can initialize it using list, and you can access on set. So, what is it? Class XS, another, class XS accessor. This is another way to do, if you are concerned about speed up. This one is mainly white on XS as its name. So, but if you want to be fast, so in fact, a hash is nothing else than several arrays, with mapping for the keys, but which are stored in an array also. But if you want to be fast, nothing could be faster than an array, okay? Perl has an internal built-in named fields, which has the advantage to be a built-in compiled feature. So you need to give some advice, some clues to the compiler when you are going to compile to say this value is of type this animal sounds, for example. So for example, you declare animal sounds with cat, dog, bird. It's like an enum with cat, dog, bird. And later in your code, you can still use hash access. And if you are not using the correct one, it's simply going to croak at that time. So this is a way to still use hashes on having a compilation errors.
So under the hood, so use fields, is that actually like creating a constant? Cat, dog, bird become constants that are used as indices?
Yeah,
that's what I assume.
So fields are good on because they look like array. They look like array. But they have a drawback, which is the lock keys. If you go under the hood of fields, you will have that sub here. On that sub, the lock key is the one that's going to slow down your application if you create a lot of objects. If you read, if you create one object and do a lot of read-write, that's fine. But if you need to create millions of objects, you will have slowness here. So there is a way to solve that. For example, use that one in development. And when you switch to production, simply mock it and disable it. Yeah. So you still want to use hash and do something else. Because your code is a 10 years old code and you have hashes all around the place. How can you control the cycle of your data using hashes? Any idea how it's possible to do such a thing there? What's happening?
Is this where you would use maybe an inside out object?
No. No. So the idea is that we are saving 45 and then we are getting 45. We are setting 1, 2, 3 on when we read that hash element, we have 99. That's tie. Okay, you can tie. How you can tie this? You tie it this way, for example. So here, the thing tie is only the edge attributes, which is tied. For example, when the value is greater than 100, we are forcing it to be 99. And we can also display at the same time running.
Just for performance.
Yeah. Just. I would not recommend that, but that's another way to control your data. So none is really better than the others. They all have advantages and drawbacks. And sometimes, yes, object might be inappropriate for your solutions. But I would say it's a good habit. Do not care about early optimizations. Just develop it easier to improve, only later when you have performance issue, you will always have solution. You will know where it's coming from and you can improve it. But do not block yourself. Do not block yourself of using objects because you will think it's going to make your code slower. Of course, in some cases it can be slower than using direct array or direct hashes, but do that. Yeah, that's what I say there. Early optimization is bad. Only do this. So that's a common problem you could have on. Yeah, you can still use inline C. You can use a POE or whatever. And in some case, in some very specific case, yes, you just replace that code or that portion of here with internal part. So here's one interesting benchmark. It's probably not up to date because I did it a few months ago. But that's the main idea. In green, this is the benchmark of a read plus update of an attribute. And in yellow or orange, this is only for try to read that value. And as you can see, you cannot have faster than array. Okay, array, that's number one. And then hash is a little slower. Well, you have fields, so fields will be hash looks like array. And then any others will have drawbacks depending if you are doing more update. In blue it's the time, the cost of the creations, initialization of the object. So depending how many objects and how many, it depends on your app. You might sometimes you might create one single object and use that one during 10 minutes and play with it with its attributes, whereas sometimes you are going to create one object, only access one attribute, and you're done. So there is none better than the others, but if you need to start with one, Moo is probably the one to go.
Did you
test with like tied hashes?
No, I don't think.
Hash plus check?
No, I don't think. I don't think it's a good habit, by the way, too. No, I've not done this one. Some common rules. If you're using Moose, you need to make your object immutable. Think about using singleton when possible. Factory also. And that's what I was talking in fields. Mock your hashutil log to be sure to disable it later in production. Be careful about any time syscall. They are consuming. Corrections are very, very good, but be aware that can comes very ugly if you are pushing everything to correction at the end. And that's that's all.
Good. Yeah.